A lone horse tears across no man's land in a dramatic scene from Steven Spielberg's movie War Horse. But the true story of the horses on the Western Front is far more epic and brutal. Between 1914 and 1918, the British Army took over 1 million horses to war. This is the story of how they got there, of the threats the animals faced.
No foot, no horse is the expression.
And of the men who kept them alive. In this age of mechanized warfare, the outcome of the first clash between horses and machine guns was terrible.
Shells were exploding in the field. There was a cacophony of noise. There was machine gun fire, rifle fire. Men were tumbling in every direction.
Their horses were completely out of control, and they were just sitting there with bullets whistling past them and explosions going on. It was complete chaos.
So how did the cavalry go on to help Britain win the war? Long past veterans recall how they suffered with their horses under heavy shell fire, did their best to care for them in atrocious conditions, and sometimes lost them in the squalor of battle.
When they couldn't get out, an officer would shoot it. It's a terrible job. You'd be upset if you saw a Dodge animal being shot.
All formed profound relationships with their horses that kept them going in the face of imminent death.
I am absolutely sure that for the soldiers and the horses that they lived and worked alongside, life was made more bearable by the fact that they were going through it together, side by side.
This is the true story of the war horse of World War One. When war broke out in 1914, Britain was still a country that relied heavily on horsepower. Horses pulled ploughs, transported goods and raw materials, and in many places were still more common on the roads than the motor car. But as the British Army set off for France, this old way of life was about to change forever. Secretary of State for War, Lord Kitchener, launched his now famous call for volunteers. And it wasn't just men he needed.
People remember the famous poster of Lord Kitchener with his finger out pointing at civilians to join the army. What they don't remember is that the British Army relied absolutely on horsepower. In 1914, it was critical to every single arm of the British Army.
But in 1914, the British didn't have enough horses to take on the Germans.
In 1914, the army only has around 26,000 horses because they don't keep large numbers of them in peacetime. Immediately on mobilisation, they have to acquire another 100,000.
Purchasing officers and veterinary surgeons were quickly dispatched to towns and villages around the country to buy horses for Britain's rapidly expanding army. If they passed muster and a price could be agreed, these animals were taken to remount depots, where they would begin their lives as army horses. Former RSPCA chief vet Mark Evans has come to the army's current remount centre in Leicestershire to find out more.
So what did the army do to suddenly go, actually we need more horses and we need them quickly?
Well, what had happened the previous few years, they'd actually set up a census, which the police did every winter, and so the army knew where every horse and type of horse was in the country.
Wow, so did they just literally march out and start turning up at farms and businesses and yeah. Bus depots?
They apparently acquired around about 140,000 horses in 2 weeks.
140,000 horses in 2 weeks, yeah. Collected by the army?
Yeah, amazing.
That's staggering.
The army's requisitioning policy quickly boosted the number of horses in service, but had a devastating effect on businesses across the country. And for many of those forced to give up their animals, it was a heartbreaking experience. Len Whitehead grew up on a farm in Suffolk.
One thing that affected me was when they took the horses. We only had four. Two of them were beautiful shire type horses. They took those, and another bay mare, which wasn't quite as big. Three of them left us just with one horse. Oh, I was sad all day at school, and I think I cried myself to sleep that night. Meant an awful lot to us, the horses. Boxer, Duke, and Violet were their names. Never saw them again, of course.
But not all horses were requisitioned. Jack Seeley was a wealthy cabinet minister and expert horseman who'd won his spurs and the nickname Galloper Jack back in the Boer War. When he volunteered in 1914, he also volunteered his horse, Warrior. And Warrior would later become one of the best-known horses of the war. Seeley wrote about their extraordinary experiences on the Western Front, a tale told by his grandson, ex-jockey and broadcaster, Bruff Scott.
Well, Warrior was a thoroughbred, which means he's higher mettle than the ordinary sort of Dobbin. Not huge, 15.2, 15.3, which is quite small for a thoroughbred, but sturdy, powerful. He was a horse that you'd long to have, you'd long to ride.
Before the war, Seeley's favourite place to ride Warrior was here, on the chalky downs near the family home on the Isle of Wight, and it soon became apparent that he was no ordinary horse.
From a young age, my grandfather would take him down to the sea. Anyone who's ridden a horse, when the waves break, a horse backs off, and he'd walk him into the waves, and they'd break over him. And there's a nice piece in the book here, this is about Warrior. He would follow the retreating water till the waves were breaking not more than 10 yards from his nose, and then stand with feet well apart while the foamy water swept past his shoulders. It was then that I first realised what an astonishingly courageous animal was mine, for I could see, though he trembled a little between my legs, that he was determined to overcome his fear. And as we will find, everything that happened subsequently showed that he overcame his fear in spades.
Seeley and Warrior would join the cavalry, an elite branch of the British Army whose glorious history would attract countless volunteers. But many of Kitchener's new recruits hailed from the cities and had never ridden a horse.
Well, for most young men who joined the cavalry, they didn't necessarily have any experience of riding at all. They would just join the cavalry because it looked more glamorous than being in the infantry. Unfortunately, that was a bit of a misrepresentation, because actually it was a lot of hard work, because the Army's way to teach people to ride is quick and brutal. Basically, you keep falling off till you figure it out.
17-year-old Smiler Marshall volunteered for the Essex Yeomanry.
You have to ride all different horses, nothing on them, no saddle, no bridle, no nothing. You have to have a stick and a little cane under each arm, and then when the riding masters cracked the whip, they'd stop then. I never come off. I'd sit there, but I'd put my arms round his neck. But half of them fell off, and the sergeant major shouted, "Who the hell told you to dismount?"
Kitchener's new army would soon be ready to join the regulars on the Western Front. However, little did they know that the face of modern warfare was about to change forever, especially for the warhorse. This is the Household Cavalry Mounted Regiment.
Remember the issues we've had in previous lessons. Make sure you start your circle nice and early. Circle at the other end, Colt Smith.
Today, they're all that remains of the 17 cavalry regiments who rode off to fight in France and Belgium in 1914. As the Queen's lifeguards, the swords they carry are deadly weapons, proven on the battlefields of the Western Front.
People often ask, you know, is the sword out of date on the battlefield in 1914 with machine guns and rifles and all the other weapons available? If you think, a soldier even today in Afghanistan still carries a bayonet, because there is a point in any battle where cold steel is still the most frightening thing available.
The swords issued to cavalrymen in 1914 were state-of-the-art weapons, and they were designed with one purpose in mind.
As you see, it's absolutely straight. In previous wars, soldiers were issued with sabres for slashing, but they found that slashing isn't actually a very effective way of killing people, to put it bluntly. Whereas with this, you give point with it, and then
If you imagine galloping towards someone with the weight of the horse, about 500 kilos of horse, travelling at up to 25, 30 mile an hour, that will go right through you.
Mobile and reactive, the cavalry could fight behind enemy lines, much like paratroopers today. And armed with rapid-fire Lee-Enfield rifles, troopers were excellent marksmen, trained to dismount and engage the enemy on foot. As these elite cavalry regiments paraded through the streets of Britain, few could imagine the horrors that lay ahead. For the horses that had been plucked from farms and stables around the country, the first trial was getting to France. Most had never even seen the sea, let alone a boat. Historian Richard Van Emden is tracing their journey to the Western Front.
Now, once down on the harbour, many of the horses became increasingly frightened, increasingly scared of going on board ship. But you've got to get them on board. The men would be pulling on ropes, tugging them, trying to get them up the ramp. If it was required, you'd get a winch, you'd get a canvas sling, you would hoist them on board ship. It was organised chaos. One particularly unpleasant story, I was told, was of a horse on deck suddenly losing control and jumping overboard. And the troopers watched in great sorrow as the ship pulled away, and they could see just ahead of the horse in the sea, swimming, trying to keep up, and of course the ship just slowly pulling away, the horse never to be seen again.
But for the horses that survived the journey, the perils of the crossing were just a portent of their lives to come. Just days after their arrival on the continent, many were suffering their first experiences of warfare. It was a far cry from the rolling fields and cobbled streets of home.
I think it's really important to remember that horses are reactive, incredibly sensitive animals, and it simply wasn't possible to prepare them properly for what they were going to endure. And when you think of what they had to go through, the stress of long distance transport, the endless hours in harness pulling heavy loads, being shot at, being bombed, the cold, the hunger, the exhaustion, it was a life that they'd never experienced, and they had no ability to understand what was going on.
However, in August 1914, General Jack Seeley's War Horse Warrior was already demonstrating his courage under fire.
My grandfather was riding out of a village past some burning stables, and he describes it very vividly, really. As we approached them, that's the stables, another bouquet of shells fell and burst, the nearest only a few yards away. To my amazement, Warrior made no attempt to run away. I could feel him tremble a little between my legs as we trotted through the gate, but he pretended to be quite unperturbed. He was trying to be brave and succeeding in his task. And ever after, that became the great hallmark, that he was a horse who would stand still, who would not panic. Of course, that would give courage to all around him.
By the 23rd of August 1914, the BEF was fighting a desperate rearguard action after being outnumbered and overrun by the Germans in Belgium. As the beleaguered infantry retreated south, the cavalry acted as a protective shield, engaging and delaying the German infantry wherever they could find them. And it was during this defensive duty that three regiments of Hussars and Lancers were involved in one of the bloodiest actions of the war, a cavalry charge near the French village of Audrigny.
Here on the 24th of August, at least 10, possibly 20,000 German infantry were going to leave the village of Quivrain and head in this direction. There were just two British battalions defending this position. They were about to be swamped, and a desperate decision had to be taken. That was for three regiments of cavalry to advance up this road and engage them.
The problem is that those cavalry arrive very G'd up and ready for a battle, and the brigadier says to them, "You've got to hold the Germans back at all costs because our men need to get away." And he uses the crucial phrase, "You may need to charge them." And unfortunately, that's a bit of a red rag to a bull to guys who are really ready for a fight. And they come flying out of the village straight towards where they think the Germans are. The problem they have is, after about a mile, they realise the Germans are a lot further away than they thought.
And as they began to run out of steam, the advancing cavalry was suddenly met by a barrage of artillery and machine gun fire and began to take heavy losses of both men and horses.
Shells were exploding in the field. There was a cacophony of noise. There was machine gun fire, rifle fire. Men were tumbling in every direction.
It was complete chaos. There were accounts of men saying that their horses were completely out of control and they were just sitting there with bullets whistling past them and explosions going on. And it's the first time they'd experienced that. They'd never been under fire before and they couldn't stop. They didn't know where they were going. Men were falling all around them and it was a terrifying experience.
War artists depicted the charge as a heroic victory, eager to feed the public the stories they wanted to hear. But the images of British cavalrymen leaping over German guns and impaling enemy soldiers were a lie.
In reality, none of the cavalrymen got within 600 yards of the German guns. In just 10 minutes, the three regiments of cavalry had lost around 250 men, killed, wounded, and taken prisoner.
In the face of machine gun fire, there was no room for brave but futile gestures like these. The generals remained convinced that there was still a role for the cavalry, but it was clear that from now on, they would need to be more tactically employed. However, as the two sides dug trenches and the war took on a more subterranean feel, cavalrymen were ordered to dismount and fight alongside the infantry. Among them was Essex boy Smiler Marshall.
My first impression was naughty, you know, there was mud, sludge, everything. Awful, terrible. All the time, you wondered whether you were going to be the next one to be killed. The padre used to say a little prayer. He said, however near, and that helped us, and that helped me, however near you are to death, there's somebody nearer. So, and that always happens in the trenches.
With the cavalry stood down and an ever-increasing army in the field, transportation became the most important role for the horse. Now, hundreds of thousands of sturdy draft horses were employed to haul wagons carrying food, water, ammunition and equipment up to the front lines. Mark Evans is at the Horse Trust in Buckinghamshire to meet military historian Andy Robertshaw to find out more.
So these are like the equivalent of the Land Rover in the First World War then?
Better than that. It's more like a transit van, 1.5 ton load, and it can go off-road.
So critical in terms of fighting the First World War?
You couldn't fight the war without the wagons, because there are very few motor vehicles. Virtually everything else is pulled by horses. 2% of the horses are cavalry. That means 98% are everything else, all transport.
And it's these guys. 98% are these guys, draft horses. Yeah. Big, stocky, sturdy draft horses like Harry. Hello, Harry. How are you, mate? Your ancestors, mate. You imagine what they must have been going through on the Western Front. I mean, you look at them from the side, they are no thoroughbred. They are, pardon the expression, but they are built like a brick shithouse,
yes,
aren't they?
Yes, yeah.
Big, strong legs and all this down here, muscles in the back, but most importantly, these huge rear end muscles, their leg muscles, that are driving this whole thing forward and are pulling a ton and a half, but they're doing it for hour after hour after hour.
No horses, no movement, you can't fight a war.
But for the drivers and their horses, the journey to the front line was fraught with danger.
You're going to be incredibly visible on the horizon,
yes,
aren't you?
Yeah,
a convoy of these trundling down, very slow moving.
Very noisy.
Potentially quite noisy too.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, the Germans, even if they don't know you're there, they'll guess that you're going to use routes and they will shell the routes you're going on. And they're going to get caught. Every half hour, shell a bit of road, you're going to catch somebody, you know, and somebody will cop it.
So it must have been carnage. I mean, when you ended up with shells arriving in a convoy of these wagons with the horses and the men,
yeah,
it must have been utter carnage.
And knowing up ahead shells are bursting and being told the guys are desperate, they need that ammunition, they need that food, get through as quickly as possible.
The most dangerous piece of road on the Western Front was a junction on the main transport line to and from the Belgian town of Ypres, known as Hellfire Corner. Protective screens were strung along the road to hide it from sight, but the Germans still rained regular salvos of shells onto passing convoys. Men and horses risk their lives running the gauntlet up to the front lines. Alfred Henn, a driver in the Warwickshire Royal Horse Artillery, was lucky to survive when the animals pulling his wagon stopped dead in the middle of the junction.
They stood still. They would not move. They would not move. All the others had gone and left me stranded in the middle. I got off them, pulled them back, front, everywhere, and I thought, it's just about time now we'll get a salvo of shells at me, which I did. And I thought, this is about the end of it. And anyway, one of them jumped just behind us, and it shot them forward, and I happened to be hanging onto the reins, and they dragged me well into safety. So I can't grumble, can I?
Even after a long shift on the wagon, the driver's day wasn't over. Before they could rest, they had to look after their horses.
Looking after a horse is no easy task, even in good times, but trying to care for one in the conditions of war, absolutely incredible job. And most of the young men who went there to do that job were city boys. They'd come out of Leeds, Bradford, Birmingham, London, no contact with horses beforehand, and suddenly they had to care for their two or more horses they were in charge of. So the public donated to charities like the RSPCA, the Blue Cross Horses Trust, to be able to provide practical help. And one critical job led by the Blue Cross was to produce this little booklet, the Drivers, Gunners and Mounted Soldiers Handbook. And it's a kind of step-by-step, almost an idiot's guide, frankly, of how to look after a horse, but incredibly valuable. You can imagine this book being in the pocket of every soldier who was working with horses.
Among those from the city now responsible for a pair of horses was Londoner Bill Cotgrove, a driver in the Royal Field Artillery.
You should make sure your horses were all right. They were your main thing, they were the horses. So we used to have to look after them properly. My horse, what I call him Elfie, rolled in all the mud he could find. So I was out to wash him down. Yes, when he got loose. So I made sure he didn't get loose.
The soldier's duty to tend to his animals every night after a long day's work in dangerous conditions was exhausting. But through it, man and horse often developed a special bond.
Now, a lot of these lads were scared. They were in a war. They could die any day. And to have something to focus on, something for which you had responsibility, gave you a lot of self-control. You could go to that horse, you could pat it, you could stroke it, you could tell him your woes, and you could give him a hug. That little bit of affection that was good for the horse, but equally good for the man.
Such was the importance placed on these relationships that the Blue Cross Handbook gave advice on how to pamper a tired horse.
It says, when a horse is tired or cold, pull his ears and hand rub his legs. It refreshes him and he will appreciate it. How touching is that?
The bond between General Jack Seeley and his war horse Warrior needed no instruction. The two were inseparable.
Warrior stayed with the general and went with him everywhere. He rode him around, and some of the time he'd follow him around like a dog.
And when Seeley was given command of the Canadian cavalry, the men were so impressed by Warrior, they adopted him as their mascot.
When Seeley came up with Warrior, they could say, oh look, here comes the general, but here comes Warrior, and they could go up to it and slap it. Slap the horse on the shoulder or on the rump, and the warrior would stand there all proud, whereas you can't slap the general on the back. And indeed, when he came up, they'd cheer, but they're not saying, here comes the general, even though he was quite popular, I think, but they said, here comes warrior, warrior's still fine, we're fine. That's the symbol, and he writes about it, it was his passport wherever he went, there's warrior. The guy with the red hat and this thoroughbred beneath him.
In 1916, Seeley rode his beloved mount to join one of the biggest collections of men and horses ever assembled on the battlefield. Warrior and the rest of the now reformed cavalry were about to face their greatest test so far in the Battle of the Somme. On the evening of the 30th of June, 1916, cavalry regiments from Britain and her empire took their final positions along a 25-mile stretch of countryside north of the River Somme. Many of these men had spent the past year fighting in the trenches, but now the generals had a new master plan, and they'd been returned to the saddle for the big push. For a week, over 1.5 million artillery shells had rained down on German frontline positions, supposedly destroying their defenses. Now 50,000 horsemen lined up, ready to follow the infantry into what was expected to be a walkover. Historian Richard van Emden has come to one quiet corner of the Somme battlefield, once part of the British front line.
We think we're familiar with the story of the Battle of the Somme. The images of British artillery firing their shells over into the German lines. The pictures of British infantrymen here packed in their frontline trenches. What we're less familiar with is the idea of thousands of horses, not 5 miles away, ready to go. British cavalry regiments ready to pour across these fields to exploit any significant hole in the German line. It must have been an incredible sight. Indian Bengal lancers, dragoons, Canadian dragoons, hussars, lancers, the elite of the British Army, there they are, armed to the teeth. Rifles stowed, swords, lancers with pennants flying. It must have been an image from a bygone age, these men raring to go, waiting for the order to advance.
Among those waiting for the battle to begin were the Canadian cavalry, led by British General Jack Seeley and his war horse Warrior.
July the 1st, 1916, they were just behind the line. The idea was after that great bombardment, it was going to be a breakthrough, and they would gallop through, all 2,000 of them, and sweep round, round up the Germans. And they were lying, lying on the ground, holding Warrior, while this huge bombardment's going overhead, imagining any minute he's going to clamber on board and go galloping through.
And as always, Warrior was raring to go.
Well, the horse, while nervous and fired up, was actually ready, determined to go forward. He wasn't backing off. I mean, God help me, when I was a jockey, you have some horses who, they find the whole thing a great strain and you know, panic a bit. There are others who you can feel the heartbeat, but they're ready to go forward. And Warrior was very much in that category.
What happened next has been well documented. The artillery bombardment failed to destroy the German defences, and in the worst day in British military history, almost 20,000 men were killed. The expected breakthrough had failed to materialise, and at 3 o'clock that afternoon, the cavalry was stood down, redundant. It was a pattern that would be repeated on the Somme until the offensive there ended in November 1916.
Being brought to this pitch of tension and anticipation and then nothing happening time and time again must have been hugely frustrating, and that frustration built with each episode, each time they were asked to come forward and nothing happened. One officer described it as like going to Ascot Week but never going to the races.
It had been a frustrating few months on the Somme, but the cavalry's time would come. In the meantime, the army was left to count the cost of the battle. The large concentration of both cavalry and transport horses had been highly vulnerable to artillery shells and aerial attack, and there were heavy casualties behind the lines. But surprisingly, most fatalities during the war came as a result of exhaustion, disease, and exposure to the extremes of weather. And the winter of 1916 proved to be one of the worst on record. The men and horses who had survived the Somme were now forced to endure a miserable existence as temperatures plummeted. Given the sheer number of ailments and injuries that could affect horses on the Western Front, the role of the veterinary corps in maintaining their health and fitness was crucial. And over the course of the war, 2.5 million animals received medical treatment. Mark Evans is at the Defence Animal Centre in Leicestershire, where the army's horses are treated today.
So what sort of problems were they dealing with in horses on the Western Front on a daily basis?
Well, you'd have, you know, debilitation just for the work they were doing and the challenge of getting the correct amount of water and food to them. And then you'd have foot injuries, particularly from nails, problems with mud fever caused by the fact they were just completely always caked in wet mud. Obviously, you've got shrapnel injuries, bullet wounds, and mange was a big problem. It transmits very easily from horse to horse, and that was quite a big issue.
In terms of resources, we now take it totally for granted as vets. We have drug cupboards full of the most sophisticated treatments available. But in those days, I mean, penicillin wasn't even found until 1928.
They didn't have antibiotics, but for a lot of wounds, they actually used mild disinfectant flush drips. So you actually continually flush through a mild disinfectant, and they actually were quite successful for a lot of the wounds. They did have anaesthetics, they had chloroform, and so quite a lot of surgery was carried out under humane conditions.
In total, 20 horse hospitals were built behind the lines. Such was their success that over 80% of the animals treated recovered and returned to duty, helping to keep Britain in the war. But there was one unseen danger that threatened all horses, and which more often than not proved fatal.
This nasty four-pointed bit of metalwork is called a caltrop, and it was used as a weapon of war by the Germans against British horses. When they were retreating, they'd scatter these on the ground, hoping to maim as many horses as possible. So you can imagine, if this was in a puddle or in mud where a horse couldn't see it, they're going to stand on it. And when they stand on it, what's so vicious about it and causes so much damage is it goes through the sole of the foot, through this fatty digital cushion here, fibrous cushion, and then right up, or was the intention, right up to here, which is the joint between the two toe bones here. That would push into that joint the muck, the debris, the mire. You would never be able to wash it out. It would become infected and impossible to treat. No foot, no horse is the expression. So once a horse has got an infection in here, it's only going one way, and it's going to meet its maker.
The army's need for horses never diminished, and with British stocks depleted, by 1917 it was importing hundreds of thousands from abroad, mostly from vast stockyards in North America. And those that reached the Western Front that year would soon be involved in some of the bloodiest fighting and most atrocious conditions of the entire war, at Passchendaele. It's a battle that has become synonymous with the sacrifice and suffering of the men who fought here. But in these terrible conditions, the animals suffered equally.
The suffering of the mules and horses here was incalculable. This is land that retains its water. It's glutinous, it's muddy, it's even now, standing here, I can feel it pulling at the soles of my shoes. In 1917, thousands of shells came over here, breaking the drainage ditches. Coupled with that and seasonally high rain, made this place nigh impossible to get through.
Regardless of the conditions, supplies and equipment still had to be taken up to the front. But as wagons and heavy horses were liable to sink without a trace, mules and pack horses bore most of the burden.
There would be tracks, mule tracks laid across these fields, and it was absolutely vital that anybody coming up here with a pack horse or pack mule stayed on them. If you came off them, especially in the dark, you were lost. You see photographs of mules up to their chests in mud, teams of men desperately trying to pull them out. Now, they would spend up to 12 hours trying to extricate a horse or a mule, but mostly it was in vain. The best thing they could do was put it out of its misery with a gunshot.
But for the men, who'd often developed strong friendships with the animals in their care, pulling the trigger was deemed beyond the call of duty. So officers were given official instructions on the best way to carry out the task.
Now, these days, horses would be euthanized with drugs. In those days, they had to get shot. So in the little field service pocketbook of 1914 that every officer carried with them, chapter 7, point 33, is just three lines that gives very clear and stark instructions about how you shoot a horse. And all you do is, come here, sweetheart, this isn't going to happen for real, sweetheart, don't worry. You lift up the forelock, where the hair starts to grow here, just below that, you put the point of your revolver just off the skin and pull the trigger. Job done. And it's an incredibly humane way to kill a horse.
For the horses on the Western Front, 1917 had proved to be the costliest year of the war so far. But with victory at Passchendaele finally achieved, there were signs that the momentum was beginning to swing in favour of the Allies. Could 1918 finally be the year of the cavalry? ...1918 would prove to be a decisive year for the war horse on the Western Front. In March, the Germans launched their spring offensive, a series of lightning attacks that broke through British positions and sent the Allies into a fighting retreat. By the morning of the 30th of March, an advanced division of the German army had moved onto the commanding heights of Moray Wood, a hilltop position just 5 miles short of the strategic town of Amiens. From here, they could strike at the railway junction below and drive a wedge between the British and French armies.
Had the Germans not been stopped at that point, they would have been into Amiens, they would have captured the railway lines, and it would have been very hard for the British and French armies to carry on.
So British General Jack Seeley and his Canadian cavalry were ordered to stop them. With his war horse Warrior beneath him, Galloper Jack would lead a cavalry charge to rout the Germans from the wood.
Before you launch a cavalry attack, someone's got to go ahead, a group of people got to go ahead and plant a flag, because that's where the others are going to go to and then go which way. Now, 20 people sent up, and my grandfather wasn't going to let other people risk themselves first without him. He was going to go up, so he, the general, and Warrior, the regimental mascot, went up first. Grandpa wrote later, "All my life had led to this." And there's no doubt that all Warrior's life had led to this.
Seeley and Warrior were staring death in the face. To beat the German guns would take stealth and courage from both man and horse.
The Germans were here on the edge of this wood with rifles and machine guns. General Seeley was over there a good mile and a half. Now he had to ride along the bottom of this slope to protect himself from the murderous fire coming from the enemy here. And they came round here and up this slope, thundering up this slope to attack the corner of this wood.
The Germans were taken by surprise, but they opened fire and men and horses fell in the field. Yet nothing could stop Warrior.
And there's no question, a thoroughbred horse like Warrior, set, galloping straight at you, was a daunting sight.
As one of Seeley's men planted the flag, three regiments of the Canadian cavalry thundered up the hill behind them.
1,000 men, very revved up, shouting, with swords and with guns with bayonets.
At the top, the cavalry poured into the wood. What happened next was brutal.
It's nasty, vicious hand-to-hand fighting. You've got dragoons on horseback skewering Germans. You've got others dismounting, getting their rifles and bayonets and going in. There's no quarter given. The Germans are resisting hard, but slowly but surely they are forced to the edge of the wood.
By the end of the day, the wood was in Allied hands. It was a turning point in the war and signalled the end of the German offensive.
The battle is also significant because it's the farthest into the British position that the Germans ever get. When they're stopped at Moray Wood, they're stopped for good.
General Jack Seeley's great charge had had the desired effect. Much of the credit should go to Warrior.
They said the bullet hadn't been made that could kill him, and amazingly, it hadn't been made that day either.
The momentum was now with the Allies, and in the summer, the British launched a counterattack that finally broke through the German lines. By now, modern technology like tanks and planes were well used to joining forces with the infantry in combined operations. But there remained a place on the battlefield for the age-old warhorse. There was still nothing to match it for pace and mobility. And with the trenches left far behind, the cavalry finally came into its own.
The last 100 days, the cavalry came back to the fore. They were back in their element. This is what they were trained for. They were now free of the trenches, pushing the Germans back over open countryside. They could get in amongst them, skirmish, scouting, just as they had done in 1914. This was their opportunity to get in there, harry the enemy, cut their communications. They were back to their best.
Essex cavalryman Smiler Marshall was finally returned to the saddle after spending most of the war in the trenches. And soon, terrified and exhausted Germans were throwing down their arms at the sight of his rapidly advancing regiment. And as he rode past lines of German prisoners, Smiler couldn't help but use the tip of his sword to teach them a lesson.
So you just prick them, you see. You just give them a prick with a sword and that was it. You didn't want, no need to kill them. You tell his mates, you want to look out. He just pricked me with that ruddy sword.
As the new mobile front line, the cavalry continued harassing the retreating Germans right up to the armistice on the 11th of November 1918. Men like Smiler greeted the end of the war with a mixture of relief and frustration that they couldn't chase the enemy all the way back to Berlin. The effect of the Great War on the horses that served was devastating. On the Western Front alone, Britain lost over 250,000 animals in the mud and squalor of battle. And as the army became increasingly mechanized, the writing was on the wall for the war horse. Never again would such vast numbers suffer on the battlefield. However, there's no doubt that Britain couldn't have won the war without them.
The Great War, as we remember it, could not have been fought without horses. And the hundreds of thousands that died during that period are almost forgotten when instead we remember, and rightfully so, the sacrifice of the soldiers. But the horses have been almost forgotten, and they played an absolutely vital role.
At the end of the war, the British Army still held 750,000 horses. What happened to them may come as a surprise, because the majority never got the hero's return they so richly deserved. The army could only afford to keep around 25,000 of the youngest and fittest horses, so of the remainder, as many as 85,000 of those most worn out by the war were shot and butchered, their meat used to feed the starving French population and the hundreds of thousands of German prisoners held in captivity. Mark Evans has come to the Army Medical Services Museum to see the evidence for himself.
This is an abattoir.
Yes.
It's just an open
on a military scale. And there's another photograph here where we've got some of the horses there that haven't been butchered yet.
Gosh, look at this though, one standing on. That is pretty shocking actually. You know, that's one thing that you would just always try and avoid.
In this process, nothing was wasted. Even the skin and bones were sold to help pay for the war.
It's kind of hard, you know, as a horse lover, that's quite hard to swallow. It must have been very hard to swallow for a lot of folk in Britain who had donated money to try and help the cause, to look after the horses, and of course the soldiers who had worked with these horses. I mean, they were their friends as well as their workmates.
They were.
Now, looking back 100 years later, it does seem like a kind of betrayal almost, doesn't it? That you've had animals that have served their country and worked so hard and ultimately could well be a major reason why we won the war, that they were around doing the job they did. And at the end of it, for some of these horses, it's... Sorry.
Yes.
It's the bullet.
It is, yeah.
However, this wasn't the fate of every horse. Although they didn't make it home, around 500,000 horses were sold to farmers in France and Belgium to help them restore the countryside that had been shattered by war. For the animals that had been requisitioned from farms in peacetime, it must have seemed like a glorious return to normality. Around 60,000 horses made it back to Britain to be sold at auction. Of those that returned, Perhaps the most famous was this team of horses known as the Old Blacks. Miraculously, they survived the entire war together and were later given the honor of pulling the carriage that carried the body of the unknown warrior to its last resting place in Westminster Abbey. And then, of course, there was Warrior. By Christmas 1918, he'd returned to his home on the Isle of Wight. And before long, Jack Seeley once again had him galloping over the chalky downs to the sea. After the horrors they'd witnessed together, it's no surprise that they remained inseparable for the rest of their lives.
20 years later, in 1938, they rode along here with 100 years between them. The man was 70 and the horse was 30. And that's very, very rare thing to happen. And for it to happen with a horse who's gone through the bloodiest war ever is, in any other words, impossible.
Warrior died in April 1941 at the age of 33. His passing announced in the Times newspaper. His story, like that of the countless other war horses who served in the Great War, should never be forgotten.
Still to come tonight, Carrie believes a terrorist attack inside the country is being planned as Homeland continues. Then Brad Pitt leads a disparate band of Nazi hunters in Quentin Tarantino's take on war movies, an Inglourious film premiere at 10.